Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to our service here tonight at the Tron. If you're visiting with us, then you're very welcome indeed. There'll be refreshments, tea and coffee and so on, served downstairs afterwards. Do stay around. There'll be some here as well. And take the opportunity to meet, encourage one another, and greet one another in the name of the Lord. The Apostle John, in his vision of the glory of heaven opened, says this: he saw all heaven fall down before him who is seated on the throne, and worship him who lives forever and ever. And they cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." We're going to begin by singing great hymn of praise, number 480. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne, while heaven's eternal anthem drowns all music but its own. Number 480.
Thank you.
Well, let's join our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. We bow before you, O Lord our God, and we cast our crowns before you, the Lion of Judah, the Lamb who was slain, the Lord, the praise of all heaven. And we surrender ourselves to you, to your sovereign rule, to your throne, to your majesty, casting all our emblems of self-rule before you and giving into your hand the total control, the full sway in our lives. It is yours to take. It is yours as sovereign Lord to control, but we yield ourselves to you gladly because we know that to give ourselves to you, the sovereign ruler, is to give ourselves into the hand of our great Savior, our Redeemer, the lover of our souls, the one who has drawn near to us to bring us the gift of life itself, the Lord of life and love and peace, the potentate of time, the creator of the rolling spheres, and yet the one who has drawn near, come down, turn your back upon the glory of heaven, the praise of heaven, to humble yourself, to make yourself as nothing in the sight of this world, to bring us the forgiveness of our sins, to restore us into fellowship with you, our Maker, with our Lord. And so, Lord, we're a people who rejoice and are glad to gather tonight to sing praise to you and to rejoice in the wonders of your love to us. Such a great salvation has come to us in Jesus, your Son. And we praise you, we thank you, we honor you with all of our hearts. And yet, Lord, we are so deeply conscious also of how great is our need still for you. You've done so much for us. You've recreated us. You've given us the life of heaven itself. And yet still in this dark world, in this veil of tears, in these bodies of death, as we walk with you upon the road to glory, we're so conscious of our needs. As the old hymn says, we need you every hour. Every hour we need you, most gracious Lord. We depend upon you for everything, for the very breath in our bodies, for the food and clothes that we need day by day, but also of the daily forgiveness that we still need, lest once again we should be estranged from you, lest our many sins should drive you from our breast, that we should grieve your Holy Spirit. We know our hearts, Lord. As we gather in your name and take your name upon our lips, we're forced to confront the reality of what we are and what we lack. At the same time as rejoicing in your grace, we find ourselves full of abject sorrow for our lack, for our sins, for the way that still we fall short day after day after day of the way that we would want to walk, let alone the way that you call us to walk. And yet, Lord, you're still the God who draws near. You've promised us never to leave us or forsake us, but to be near, to hear us, to hear the cries of our hearts, to hear the prayers that we bring to you, the cries for you once again to forgive us afresh. Oh, we thank you that we come in the knowledge of your great grace, your abundant mercy, your ever-hearing ear. For everyone who asks will receive. Everyone who knocks, the door will be opened again and again and again. If we come humbly, knowing our sins, but seeking our Savior. So, Lord, we come to you tonight once again, seeking your grace, but knowing that you're a God who loves us to seek you, And when we do, who loves to lavish again, freshly, day after day, your mercy, your grace, your love that covers a multitude of sins. So hear us, Lord. Grant us the desire of our hearts to know afresh the assurance that only you can give us in this world, that indeed our sins are forgiven, that there's nothing between us, that we can enjoy and still rejoice in the fellowship that we know with the Father through Jesus Christ, your Son. So come to us, Lord, in the peace and in the quietness of this evening hour, as we gather together in Jesus' name, come to us and fill us afresh with his Holy Spirit. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're thinking about the subject of prayer and the Lord's Prayer. We're going to sing again a hymn that teaches us something of that, number 612. Prayer is the soul's sincere desire expressed in thought or word, the burning of a hidden fire, a longing for the Lord. Number 612. Well, take up your Bibles, and we're going to read together in the Scriptures in the New Testament, in Matthew's Gospel. In two places this evening, we're going to read in a moment in Matthew chapter 6, passage we've been studying, the Lord's Prayer. That's page 811 if you have one of our blue Bibles. But if you'd like to stick your finger in there and then turn a few pages further on to Matthew chapter 18. And first, we're going to read some words of the Lord Jesus from Matthew 18 and verse 21. Matthew 18 and then back to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew 18, 21, we're told, Peter came up and said to Jesus, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you seven times, but 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when that same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, 100 pennies. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, pay what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. He refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to the master all that had taken place. Then his master summoned him and said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he could pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. Let's turn back to Matthew chapter 6, and we'll read at verse 9. Jesus says to his disciples, in contrast to the pagans and to the hypocrites, the religious people, you then pray like this, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For, says the Lord Jesus, if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Amen. May God bless to us his word. Well, God has forgiven us a very great deal, hasn't he? And our hearts should be full of great thankfulness. And we're going to sing now the hymn on the screens that reminds us that that is so. Our hearts are filled with thankfulness to him who bore our pain. Well, we have a few moments of quiet as our offerings are received and as the musicians play. You might like to read again and meditate on these words of the Lord's Prayer we'll be looking at again shortly, or perhaps just indeed to be in prayer quietly. But as we do that, our offerings are received. Pray. The music reminds us of the Lord Jesus Christ who cometh to make up his jewels, the jewels for his crown, that every day between now and then, every day through the history of this world, he's been gathering those stray sheep into his fold. Those from every tribe and people and tongue and nation, called to belong to Jesus Christ, called to be stones, living stones, precious stones, treasured possessions, being built into his house, his home, a place where he will dwell forever. Lord, our great desire is that we should be bright, shining, precious jewels in your hands, that through the burnishing, the polishing, the abrading, and the many testings, purifyings, that in your mercy and in your grace you allow us to go through as we tread the path of faith, following in the way of your cross, that through all of that, we shall at last come forth as gold. So help us, Lord, to take your correction, your rebuke, your challenge, your instruction, your training in righteousness, that we might be wise for salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, and that we might be equipped for every good work that you have for us to do. So open our eyes, Lord, and open our hearts as we come now to your word. Fill us with knowledge of your goodness and grace, and lead us in the way everlasting. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as we come to study the Lord's Prayer, then we sing once again our sung version, Our Father God, who dwells in heaven. Thank you. Well, it will help if you open your Bibles at Matthew chapter 6, and to these very familiar words that we know as the Lord's Prayer. We've been studying this now for a week or two, and I think what we've already seen, I hope what we've seen, is that when our hearts are right, then our prayer will be right. That's the message that the first half of the Lord's Prayer teaches to us. That when our hearts are right, we will address God personally, because our relationship with him is real. We really know him through the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we know him as our Father, verse 9, our Father in heaven. And because that's true, we, in our prayers, we will align ourselves with God's purposes. It's verse 10, we'll pray that his kingdom come, and that his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Not our will, but his. Not my will, but thine. And we have the true kingdom perspective then that really runs all through Jesus' teaching here in Matthew chapter 6. And it's important, isn't it, not to pull the Lord's Prayer out of its context here. It's part of this whole teaching of Jesus in this great chapter of the Sermon on the Mount. Look down to verse 33. It's such an important verse. It means, you see, if we have that right attitude, we are people who seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Because we know that if we do that, then everything else that we truly need, God will indeed add to our lives. And our minds, therefore, are on treasures in heaven, not treasures on earth. Because our beloved Master is our Father in heaven. Our Master is not the filthy lucre, the things of this world, the things that the pagans set their eyes on and long for. But of course, we are still earthly creatures. We're still living in this world, aren't we, until the Lord Jesus comes again. So of course, we do have needs. We have need to provide for our lives. And when we pray aright, as verses 9 and 10 would teach us to, when we are seeking first God's kingdom, then our prayer for our present earthly needs, which are all too real, then they'll be like the second half of the Lord's Prayer. We will think about the provision for our earthly needs, of course we will. But we'll pray as Jesus teaches us to. To acknowledge God's provision, to acknowledge that it's real, and to acknowledge that it is sufficient for all of our lives, for everything that we need. And verses 11 and 12 speak of two aspects of God's provision for our lives that it's right that we should acknowledge in prayer: his provision of our daily food and also of our daily forgiveness. So first, we're to acknowledge in prayer God's provision of our daily food. Verse 11, the first half, give us this day our daily bread. Now notice the footnote there. It could be tomorrow's bread. Scholars argue about that, whether it's bread for today or bread for tomorrow. Maybe you're praying in the evening and it's tomorrow's bread. Well, let's not worry about that. Let's not fall into the trap of academics. I expect there's probably 57 PhDs on whether it's today's bread or tomorrow's bread. But I don't think it really matters, does it? You don't really need a PhD or to be a biblical scholar to work out what Jesus means us to do. It's pretty plain. We're to ask God for daily bread, that is, for food. It's a general term, isn't it? It's bread, it's food, but it's a general term, meaning our general physical needs, provision for our earthly life, the sort of things that we need as human beings to go about daily life and our daily work, our business of serving God. And of course, Jesus expands on that in verse 25 and following, that whole section there about not being anxious. And it's clear from that that daily bread doesn't just mean literally bread or even just food, but it is what we eat, what we drink, what we wear. It's shorthand for all the necessities of life. All the things that verse 32 says our Heavenly Father knows perfectly well that we need and indeed provides for us. And that's the point, you see. We're to ask for his provision, but we're to acknowledge that it is his provision. Put a you at the beginning of verse 11, and you'll get the point perfectly. You give us this day our daily bread. You see, God knows all that we need, including the physical, down-to-earth things that we need. And he will provide. He will provide food and clothes and shelter and money for the gas bill, whatever it might be. But he wants us to ask him to provide and to acknowledge that it actually is God who is providing all of these things for us. As we sometimes say, in the hymn that we sing, all good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. So thank the Lord for all his love. Now that's easy to say, but it's actually also very easy to forget to do, isn't it? To be thankful. I take it that must be why the New Testament is full of so many commands to be thankful, isn't it? 1 Thessalonians 5, in all circumstances, give thanks. Read Colossians chapter 3 again and again. All the way through the Bible, we're told, give thanks, give thanks. Why is that? Well, it must be because we forget to give thanks. We forget to acknowledge all that God does give us. But you see, to ask God daily for earthly provision for our basic needs, it reminds us, doesn't it, to acknowledge with thankfulness when God does provide. It helps us to remember to be thankful people and to be contented people too, not like the pagans. Look again at verse 32. Remember, Jesus says it's the pagans who are constantly grasping after things, all these things, earthly treasures, the things that we so easily fall in love with in this world. But no, rather, we're to be people who acknowledge that our earthly needs will be met and are being met from God in his grace. And in God's time and in God's chosen way, his good and perfect way, which may be different from our way sometimes. To bow to God in that way, to acknowledge God's provision in that way, is really to bow to his primacy. It's not to assert our own primacy. That's what it means, you see, to pray, Lord, you give us this day our daily bread. It's praying, Lord, we trust you to provide for all our needs, not all our wants. And we trust you to do it your way, the way you think is best for us. Not necessarily the way I think is best. It's the essence of sin, isn't it, to refuse to do that? That was the story of Eden, wasn't it? Go back to the beginning of the Bible, to the first two chapters of Genesis. God gives a wonderful provision, doesn't he, of daily bread in that perfect paradise. Eat from all the trees of the garden, every single one of them, a bountiful, perfect, beautiful provision for all the daily needs of human life. You can have it all, except just one. Just that one way. There's only one way for you to not have your daily bread, the anti-God way. That's the only way I don't want you to do it. The way that sticks two fingers up at me. Why on earth would you want to do that when I've given you all of this? But of course, that's so often the very way that human beings insist on having it, isn't it? The one way that God says you can't have that good gift. From Eden then to Europe today, where just the same, we pervert so easily the gift of God's grace because we want to have it our way, not his way. Think of God's good gift of sexual relations. Another thing that is right there back in Genesis chapter 2. A great gift of God to bless the human relationship of marriage. And what do we say to God? Sex? Yes, thank you very much. We'll have that. Plenty of it. Marriage? No thanks. We don't want that. We'll have it our way. Or else we'll turn upside down and pervert the whole concept of marriage so it's something quite different to what you invented, God. We'll have the gift, but we want it our way. Thank you very much. Not your way. We'll have our daily bread, but we'll have it on our time, in our way. It's not wrong to pray for these areas of our lives. But we need to pray for God's gifts in God's way to come to us. Think of Israel in the wilderness. And God provided them with manna, bread from heaven. Delicious, far more delicious than ordinary bread. tasted like wafers and honey. That's what Exodus teaches. I'll never forget, when I was a boy in the Sunday school, my Sunday school teacher brought in one day a beautiful bit of honeycomb and wafers, and he gave us out all bits of it to show us what manna tasted like. It's amazing what you remember, isn't it? Never forget that Sunday school lesson. I even remembered actually what it was about. Most illustrations, all you remember is the illustration. But God provided this wonderful thing, manna, to teach his people to look to him to provide for them his way and to see what a wonderful way his was, not just bread, but lovely honeycomb. In other words, he was saying, I want you to learn to trust me, to do it my way. And what happened? Well, God said, here's the way it works. You can gather enough for one day, and you have to trust me that it'll be there tomorrow just the same. And what did they do? Well, I don't know if it'll be here tomorrow. This is terrific stuff. Let's get some extra, and we'll put it in the bin for tomorrow. What are they doing tomorrow morning? They wake up, and it's full of maggots and rot. And God says, why do you not obey me and listen to me and do it my way? And then God said the opposite thing to them, didn't he? He said, now you're not to gather any on the Sabbath. I don't want you going out gathering manna on the Sabbath. So what you do on the day before the Sabbath is you gather twice as much. And it will be fine for you tomorrow. And they said, don't catch us with that maggot thing. We're not having those maggots. No way. We'll get enough for today. We'll go out tomorrow morning. Then it'll be there. And there wasn't any there. And the Lord said, when will you listen to me and trust me to give you my good gifts, my way? How difficult can this be? And Deuteronomy 8, verse 3, God says, all of this was to teach you that man doesn't live by bread alone, but by everything that comes from the mouth of the Lord. In other words, it's not just bread that we need, but it's God's bread, God's way. And we need to acknowledge that daily and to trust him for all of our needs, not just to seek after all these things our way and for ourselves, but rather to submit all things to God and to his provision, his way at his time, and not ours. Our food and clothing needs, yes. Our work needs. Our desire for a life partner, maybe, yes. All these things that are part and parcel of ordinary daily human life and that concern us. But we're to pray, Lord, you give it to us. Your way, in your time. You give us this day our daily bread. That was Jesus' prayer, wasn't it, in the desert? In Matthew chapter 4, when Satan offered him bread and said, you're very hungry, aren't you? Here's some stones. You're the Son of God. Turn the stones into bread. And what did Jesus say? Yes, I'd love some bread. But man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. He learned, didn't he, what Israel in the desert hadn't learned, that it's God's bread in God's way. So real prayer acknowledges God's provision and trusts it. You see what balance that gives, what liberty that brings to our whole attitude of the material world, to this world's bread. We're not to be ascetics as Christians. We're not to despise bread and all the normal things, the good gifts that God has given in human life. Extreme abstinence isn't some special pious thing, some very spiritual thing for Christians. Actually, Paul says in 1 Timothy 4, it's demonic, that kind of thinking that despises God's gifts. Now, we're to receive with thanksgiving all God's good gifts. He richly provides them, says Paul. He richly provides them for us to enjoy. But we're not to worship mere bread. We're not to worship these mere material things and live for these mere material things. And some Christians do that. It's the opposite of asceticism. Paul puts it rather starkly, doesn't he, to the church in Philippi. Their God is their belly. Well, he's not speaking literally, although that actually can be true as well, can't it? People can be addicted to food and drink and so on. But what he's saying is, don't worship mere passing earthly treasure, earthly bread. Just like the manna, it's only temporary. Enjoy when God gives it, but it's there principally to remind you this earthly bread, it's there to remind you of the heavenly bread, of the living bread, of the bread that promises us eternal life. And see, acknowledging God's provision of earthly bread reminds us about God's future promise in the gospel of Jesus, which is the bread of everlasting life. That whoever comes to me will never hunger, and whoever believes in me will never thirst. That's really why Christians give thanks at mealtimes, isn't it? That's why we call it saying grace. It's not blessing the food. We can't bless food. How can food be blessed? It can be eaten. We're not blessing the food, but what we're doing is acknowledging God's provision. And as we acknowledge God's provision of this earthly bread, it reminds us, or it ought to remind us, of God's glorious promise for the future. Every time we eat earthly bread, every time we drink something, every time we enjoy something of God's provision in this world, it should remind us, shouldn't it, to give thanks for the heavenly bread, for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, for the bread of life who promises us everlasting life. So we're to pray for provision, for daily food, and acknowledge that it is God's provision of God's bread in God's way. And then the second part is that we're to acknowledge, according to Jesus, we're to acknowledge God's provision of daily forgiveness. Second half of verse 11. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. Now notice that this prayer has two aspects to it, although they're absolutely inseparable. Jesus says we're to ask both for the experience of forgiveness, forgive us our debts, but also for the expression of forgiveness, as we forgive our debtors. So first, notice that it is a genuine prayer for a real experience of God's forgiveness, for the experience daily of the unbroken fellowship with God our Father through Jesus. You see, to ask for forgiveness is at the same time to acknowledge our need for forgiveness, isn't it? And that it can only come to us from God, that we can't find it anywhere else. It has to come from Him. It can't arise within us. You need to forgive us our debts. But we've to ask, and God has promised to provide forgiveness. And to pray this, you see, is simply to express real faith in God's promise, real trust, real obedience to His command to ask Him. That Jesus really did come to bring forgiveness from sins for those who ask Him. And Jesus wants us to ask for forgiveness. Ask, and it shall be given to you. Seek, and you'll find. Knock, the door will be opened to you. God loves us to ask for the things that He has promised to give to us. And that's what faith is. It's asking for the things that God has promised. It's responding to God's promised word. The whole Old Testament teaches that, doesn't it? That every sacrifice that was brought to the temple, to the altar, according to God's word, it said to God, Lord, remember your covenant mercy. Remember that you've promised to forgive us our sins on the basis of these sacrifices. And God was delighted to forgive. Remember in the dedication of the temple, Solomon's temple, 1 Kings 8, and he promises, doesn't he, that whoever prayed to God towards his temple, his chosen place of mercy, that God would hear, God would forgive. Hear in heaven, he said, and forgive the sins of your people. Because, see, to ask for what God has promised to those who truly seek Him, His way, is to have faith. And therefore, it is to find God's forgiveness. But of course, to ask in that way is also at the same time to show repentance, because it's to acknowledge, isn't it, our helplessness, our need. To ask God that way for forgiveness means we're coming humbly because we need it. We're coming penitently. We're seeking God's Spirit to change our hearts, to turn us away from sin, to help us to walk in step with the Spirit of Jesus. And that's what experience of forgiveness of our sins really means. And that's what's expressed, you see, in the second part of the petition. Because it is a prayer for a genuine expression of forgiveness, to forgive our debtors. That speaks of the penitent heart, of the merciful one who Jesus says alone is the one who can actually receive God's mercy. Now let's be clear here. We need to be clear because repentance, in that sense, is not a condition of forgiveness. God's forgiveness is unconditional in that sense because Paul says it was while we were enemies that we were reconciled to God. Not because we asked, but because God in his sovereign mercy reached out in an act of mercy and drew us to himself while we were still enemies. But nevertheless, the Bible is very clear that repentance is a necessary consequence of God's forgiveness. We can't receive God's forgiveness without repenting. And we can't be real recipients of the mercy of God without becoming merciful people. It's just not possible. Smiling isn't a condition of happiness, is it? But happy people will inevitably smile. When have you ever seen a happy person who never smiles? Impossible, isn't it? Just as a generous person will always be a giver. There's no such thing as a theoretically generous person, is there? Some people think they're theoretically generous. No. You can't be generous without actually giving. And you see, that is to acknowledge God's forgiveness of us. You, Lord, forgive us our debts. And that means that forgiveness must flow out of us to others. Forgiveness is a thing that must be expressed. There's no such thing as inexpressible forgiveness. Because God's condition is not a commodity to be received by us, like a bag of something. Half a pint of forgiveness, please. No, God's forgiveness is his personal transforming power that we experience, that changes us, turning us into people who are sons of the Father in heaven. In verse 21, you see, Jesus says, doesn't he, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And if what you truly treasure is God's mercy, God's forgiveness, then how can your heart not be overflowing with forgiving mercy? I mean, it's as simple as that, isn't it? Impossible for it not to be. Because to know God's forgiveness is to know God personally, the forgiving God. It's to know the joy of real reconciliation with God the Father himself, and therefore to know that reconciliation with all of God's true family. And you see, the New Testament teaches us that the latter is evidence of the former. Remember Jesus' story of the elder brother? Didn't want to go in, would not go into the party, didn't want anything to do with those who were sons of the Father. How could he really be a son of the Father? He wanted nothing to do with the others. And lack of that true reconciliation with God's family is also, according to the Bible, lack of evidence of true reconciliation with the Father. And that's the point, isn't it, of that parable that we read in Matthew chapter 18, Jesus' story of the unforgiving servant. Just turn around again and have a look at that. There was a man, wasn't he, who was forgiven a vast sum by his boss, by his master. 10,000 talents. 200,000 years of wages, apparently. Sounds about like the UK national debt. It's a very large sum. But he wouldn't forgive a fellow servant who owed him just a few months of wages. Just a few months. And surely the point is that his unforgiving heart, his unmerciful heart, showed that in fact his heart hadn't been changed at all by his experience of mercy from the master. And he didn't really know his master at all. You could say the master's spirit, if you like, was entirely absent from his life, from his behavior, from the way he treated others. And that's why Jesus said that servant was cast away from the master's presence. And very chilling words in verse 35. So it will be for you, says Jesus, if you don't forgive your brother from your heart. He's simply saying, isn't he, that an attitude of unforgiveness to others is evidence, really, of our own unforgiveness, of our own lack of a real saving relationship with God the Father in our own life. And that's why back in Matthew 6 here, after the Lord's Prayer, we have these two added verses in 14 and 15 to press that point home. Look at yourselves carefully, he's saying. Don't just recite this prayer. Because a heart attitude of unforgiveness, well, that's something that's characteristic not of heaven, but of hell. Not of our Father, but of the devil. It's true, isn't it, that for the people of this world, revenge is sweet. Walter Scott put it sweetly, didn't he? Revenge is the tastiest morsel ever cooked in hell. And we see it in the world all around us, don't we? When someone's been wronged. Desire for revenge. That's why litigation lawyers will never be out of a job, even if there's a big recession. And divorce lawyers, the same, sadly. Friends, the truth is that in our experience of forgiveness, we tell the world about the God of heaven and about his heart, that he is infinitely full of mercy, infinitely forgiving, that he loves to forgive, even though it costs him immeasurably. But in our expression of forgiveness, we tell the world and we tell God about our own hearts and the truth about what's deep in here. Because the true mercy of heaven changes the human heart. And a changed heart will always show visible signs, things that can be seen, things that can be heard, things that will tell the real truth about that organ that's deep within. Most of you know I used to be a heart doctor. I know the signs of a healthy heart, and I know the signs of an unhealthy heart. You could spot it when the patient walked in the door, in their face, in their color, the way they were breathing, in their neck, in their ankles, their fingers. I'm a bit worried about a few of you, actually, just looking around here. No, I'm only kidding. But we used to have these things in medical exams. Those of you who are doctors and medical students will know. Spot diagnosis. Somebody walks in. What's wrong with them? And the signs on the outside tell you immediately about very damaging pathology deep within, in the heart. And that's what Jesus is saying, you see, in verses 14 and 15. It's a spot diagnosis. Verse 14 is a sign, a cardinal sign of a healthy heart. If you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. This is a merciful, forgiving person. Someone who shows mercy in Christ's name. That's a true child of God. It's obvious. God knows him, and he knows God, and he loves God. And his heart is possessed by the love and the mercy and the forgiveness of his heavenly Father. But verse 15, you see, is a spot diagnosis of a hard-hearted, unforgiving person. And though they call themselves a Christian, though they say, Lord, Lord, all the time, and though they even do wonders in Christ's name, as some do, Jesus says in Matthew 7:21, if that's the way they are, deeply unforgiving, then they don't know the Father in heaven. They can't. Because their heart hasn't been changed. Their heart is hard. It's sclerotic. It's calcified. It's hardened against their brother and their sister. And you remember in Matthew 7 to those people, Jesus on the last day says those terrible words, I don't know you. I don't recognize you. I don't recognize the language of your life. I just don't see the Spirit of my Heavenly Father in you. I just don't think you can be one of those that the Father has given me. Sometimes you see people want the forgiveness of God without the God of forgiveness. But it's just not possible. It's both or it's neither. Actually, often what those people don't want is real forgiveness through reconciliation with God. What they want is to get rid of a bad conscience. They want to just get on with life. Like the disgraced boss of BP, remember, after the Deepwater Horizon, that famous comment, "I just want my life back." That's not repentance, is it? That's just remorse. That's just saying, "I regret all the things that are happening to me, so I want forgiveness." But I don't really want the forgiving God, who in truly forgiving me will change me and turn me into a person who treats others the way that he has treated me. Now, forgiveness from God and fellowship with God go together. And that means always, you see, that experience of true forgiveness for us and expression of true forgiveness from us, those are they're inseparable things in the Christian faith. And that's why Jesus says here, "You then pray like this for your daily food and your daily forgiveness. You give us this day our daily bread, and you forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors." Well, let's pray. O Lord, your present blessings we receive with glad thanksgiving. To daily bread, add daily mercy to forgive as we're forgiven. And so prove the grace of your heaven. Amen. Well, we're going to sing as we close this lovely hymn that you'll find at number 824. "Forgive our sins as we forgive, you taught us, Lord, to pray, but you alone can grant us grace to live the words we say." How true that is. Number 824. And so may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the grace we so desperately need, and the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit be with you all evermore. Amen.